Robert, the 10 worst corporations of 2008. That's tough. That's a tough decision, isn't it? I mean, there's just been so much going on out there this year. But I looked at this, and I'm interested in your criteria. First of all, you start out with saying there are certain things that we look at that we help define what that worst corporation is. One, for example, you start off with the criteria of improper political influence. What do you mean by that?
Well, we focus on the ways that corporations leverage their economic power to influence the political arena to then expand their economic power at the expense of citizens. We emphasize the ways that the financial crisis exemplifies this, where all of the deregulatory moves over the last 10 years and really over the last 30 years led us to the point where we're at with the financial crisis. But we got those deregulatory moves not just because people thought they were good ideas, but because Wall Street was able to exert its political power in Washington.
So one thing you look at, for example, the World Trade Organization, you might look at not only how do they have influence in local city councils, I mean, to some degree they do, but global institutions. What is it that they do to leverage their political power and influence regulations? That would be one thing you would look at. How about deregulation and non-enforcement? I mean, the non-enforcement issue, non-enforcement of rules against predatory lending, for example, helped the housing bubble take place and the balloon burst in the end. But that's one of the things you look for, isn't it, when you try to evaluate these corporations?
And again, it's a government failure, but it's a government failure that stems from corporate power, and it's for sure at the center of the housing and financial crisis, but you can look at almost any social problem, and there are some reasonable rules on the books. Usually much more needs to be done because of what we were just talking about, but even the reasonable rules are typically not well enforced, whether it's workplace safety or consumer protections or privacy protections or guaranteeing the rights of people when they go to a hospital.
Well, and so they'll use, when you're looking at these corporations, again, when we're talking about the 10 worst corporations, before we get into it, I just kind of want to get the lay of the land. But one thing that you would look at, I remember reading about your the Financial Services Modernization Act of 1999, where you had this, what's described as civil disobedience. You actually had Citibank and Travelers Group merge in 1998. It was illegal, completely illegal. But nevertheless, the government said, hey, you can do this, and maybe someday it'll be legal.
Yeah, they were able to get a temporary waiver for the prohibition on the merger of a commercial bank and an insurance company. Then, sure enough, within the course of the next year or so, they were able to get the law repealed, the longstanding Glass-Steagall law that had forbidden them from merging as they had already done.
Yeah, almost like a drug importer saying that I want to import marijuana. You let me do it, and I think we can make this legal over the next 5 years. It's kind of the same analysis.
It is a little, one difference is that if the marijuana importer had done that and failed, then they would just stop importing, and you could see that scenario. Once Citibank and Travelers merged, there was no scenario in which they could reasonably be expected to unmerge. So they were guaranteeing effectively that they would get the law changed.
Mm, yeah. Short-term thinking, obviously, that's something that you look at. I've talked to you before about this, and that we'll talk about as we go through these corporations. Financialization. Talk about that. The way I looked at that is almost as like we don't build anything anymore. These corporations don't really make anything. There's no, there's no social use to what they do. It's become this purveyor of financial instruments that are just nothing but smoke and mirrors, and it's almost illusory and fantasy kind of stuff.
Yeah, and we can really see the radically different treatment given to the Wall Street firms needing money and the auto firms, which for all their flaws actually produce something that people use and need given our current social arrangements. But what we saw, not this year, because things are going very bad for Wall Street, but in the previous 3 years or so, the financial sector was raking about a third or more of all corporate profits in the United States. So what had really happened was that the financial sector had metastasized out of any reasonable role in the overall economy, and instead of serving the real economy, it had come to dominate it.
Yeah, in other words, there's no social purpose. They create these widgets that we can call swaps or synthetics or derivatives. They don't mean anything. They don't build cars. They don't build airplanes. They don't really add to anything that creates a huge social impact. It's just a way to move money around. How about externalized costs? We always see this. This is something that I see consistently when you evaluate corporations. Talk about that a little bit.
Well, it really explains the worst things that companies do. they have all kinds of harms are perpetrated by these companies. If the companies were themselves forced to pay the cost of those harms or internalize them in economic terms, they probably wouldn't do those things. But they're able to foist the costs off onto the public, whether it's a dollar cost or cost to human health or the environment through pollution. Say.
Typically, we see that with environmental cases. For example, I tried one up in West Virginia where DuPont had put up just tens and tens of millions of dollars of these costs onto a local community, and taxpayers had to end up paying for it for the cleanup. That's true externalization, right?
That's exactly right. And I think one thing that we're seeing with the financial meltdown, but in many other areas, is they both externalize actual harm and the risk of harm. So sometimes it's not for sure that something bad is going to happen, but there's a chance it's going to happen. And one way or another, they say, well, if there's going to be a problem, that's not going to be our problem. It'll be the public's problem.
All right, let's take a quick break. We're going to be right back with Robert Weissman. We're talking about the 10 worst corporations of 2008.